مولاي صل وسلم دائما أبدا على حبيبك خير الخلق كلهم. مولاي صل وسلم دائما أبدا على حبيبك خير الخلق كلهم. محمد سيد الكونين.
إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستغفره ونستعينه ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن سيدنا محمدا عبده ورسوله أرسله بالحق بشيرا ونذيرا بين يدي الساعة صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. أما بعد، فيقول تبارك وتعالى بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم: وما أرسلناك إلا رحمة للعالمين. ويقول تبارك وتعالى: وإنك لعلى خلق عظيم. صدق الله العظيم. My dear respected ulama, imams, elders, brothers, sisters, mothers, and children, assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. We are in fact honored to be speaking about Rasulullah and to be listening about the seerah of Rasulullah, for we will never add honor to his status sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, for Allah Ta'ala honored him enough. And so the tashrif or the sharaf or the honor and the nobility is given to us for being given the tawfiq or the divine ability to be standing here and to talk about him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And that in itself is worth more than we can ever imagine. But we are so meager and so insignificant that no amount of lectures and no amount of words will ever do justice to his greatness sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The best that we can do is perhaps to begin to speak about his greatness and to give a rather perhaps simple picture and image of his greatness, because we can never appreciate that greatness. We weren't there with him to see him. We weren't there to see his greatness and to see the mu'jizat and the miracles that Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala gave him. But fortunate are those who were with him and who saw him. And that is why they were the best of humanity after the prophets عليهم الصلاة والسلام. Anyone who laid his eyes on Rasulullah and was a Muslim, even for a second he became or she became a Muslim, and for a second they laid their eyes on him sallallahu alayhi wasallam and passed away after that second, they became Sahaba. They became the disciples, and they are, according to the unanimous opinion of the ulama, are better than anyone else to come after them. Because of the greatness of the man whom they saw, and the greatness of the man with whom they dealt. And in order for us to comprehend his greatness, Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala himself states few things about him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam by way of praise when he says, wa innaka la'ala khuluqin azim, and you, O Muhammad, stand on the highest of character or moral character. There is no one like you, in other words, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And there is no one who stepped a foot on this earth and no one will ever step a foot on this earth like him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He was the most beloved to Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And as Imam Ibn Qayyim al-Jawziyyah rahmatullahi alayhi summed it up in his book Al-Fawaid, saying that when Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam perfected his ilaqa or his relation with Allah ta'ala, Allah ta'ala made everybody else in need of him in this dunya and in akhirah. For none can attain success in dunya without following his footsteps. And none will enter Jannah without being a follower of him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He is the one who will first knock at the gates of Jannah, and he to whom the gates of Jannah will first be opened sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he is the one whom Allah ta'ala in the Quran said to him that we shall keep giving you until you are pleased. When Musa alayhi salam was going to the mountain to receive wahi or inspiration, he was running towards the mountain. And Allah ta'ala asked him, why are you running, O Musa? He says, عَجِلْتُ لَكَ رَبِّي لِتَرْضَى. Oh Allah, I'm coming hurriedly towards you so that you may become pleased. But Allah ta'ala, when he speaks about his Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, وَلَسَوْفَ يُعْطِيكَ رَبُّكَ فَتَرْضَى. Allah shall keep giving you until you are pleased, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When the kuffar of Mecca teased him because he could not have male progeny, or the male progeny that he had passed away, and all that remained were his eminent, honorable, illustrious female progeny, but no male progeny, they teased him and they said, you are abtar, you are maqtu', you are disconnected, you don't have a male progeny. And when that slight sadness came in his heart sallallahu alayhi wasallam, Allah ta'ala from above seven heavens reveals a whole chapter to soothe him sallallahu alayhi wasallam by saying to him, inna a'tainaka al-kawthar fasalli li rabbika wanhar inna shani'aka huwa al-abtar. We have given you kawthar. We have given you kawthar. And kawthar, the commentators say, could mean one or two things. Abundance. We have given you abundance of what nobody else can have. Or kawthar, the kawthar that we know of, or that he told us about, the kawthar in Jannah. On that day when he will call his followers to the kawthar. Inna a'tainaka al-kawthar. Do not be sad, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We have given you kawthar. So busy yourself in salah and sacrifice. For indeed, your enemies are the ones who are cut off. You are not cut off. The fact that you don't have a male progeny doesn't mean you are cut off. You are connected to the greatest, Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. But they are the ones who are cut off. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was chosen by Allah ta'ala. Allah ta'ala looked through the hearts of all of his creations and chose the prophets alayhim as-salam as the best. And from all the hearts of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he chose Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to be the seal of the prophets. He is the icing on the cake, as somebody said. He is the one who comes to seal that legacy, to perfect it, to add the greatest beauty unto it, and to deliver people from the darkness of worshipping other than Allah to Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. So it was a deliberate, calculated choice by Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. For he is the best, was the best, and shall remain the best, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then he was known before his nubuwa as truthful and trustworthy. He was loved before his nubuwa, before receiving prophethood. He was loved even more when he was a prophet. And he remains to be loved by billions of Muslims and shall continue to do so till the day of Qiyamah. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Even his enemies, those who fought against him when they were asked to be truthful about him, like Abu Sufyan, when he was asked, he spoke nothing but good about Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the moment of truth came when Allah Ta'ala decided at age 40 to send him Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam. when he was meditating in the cave, for he was aloof from the practices of the society of the day. He did not like their worship of idols and statues. He did not like their habit of drinking wine and intoxicants. He did not like their habits of womanizing, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, before he was given nubuwwah. Why? Because of the fitrah, the good fitrah that was in him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. For if you may recall, when he was a child playing with other children, Jibreel alayhi salam came and opened his chest and took his heart out and washed it from water from Jannah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and placed it back. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, everybody has in his heart a black dot that grows with sin or disappears with goodness. The only one whose black dot was taken out was Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So much so that even shaitan could not whisper to him when he came one day, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to his house. And Aisha radiallahu anha, his wife, waiting for him, he's coming late. So she stood there at the door like any woman who would be concerned about where her husband was. She said, were you with the other wives? She said, are you jealous, Aisha? Did your shaitan come to you, O Aisha? She says, why do I have a shaitan? She said, yes, everybody has a shaitan with him. She said, even you have a shaitan with you? He says, yes, walakin shaitani aslam. But my shaitan has become a Muslim. Or some ulama interpret it in two ways. One is that literally he had actually submitted. And he said, I can't. If you can't beat them, join them. If you can't defeat them, join them. Or it means he cannot whisper evil to Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then he was given nubuwwah. If we were able to freeze that moment in history, and if we are given the fortune of being to glean through that cave and to see him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when Jibreel had come to him, perhaps in Jannah, inshallah ta'ala, one of the things we can ask, Ya Allah, I want to see that moment. For Allah ta'ala says, for the believers, whatever they want. And so you should ask for more than the satisfaction of the body. And perhaps we could ask, Ya Allah, I want to see that moment. Show me, Ya Allah, that moment when Jibreel alayhi salam came to him in the cave. And that moment when he reacted to the scene of Jibreel alayhi salam. We don't know what happened to his heart at that moment. Nobody could tell us. Allah Ta'ala only knows. And that moment when he was embraced by Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam, when he ran back to his beloved wife Khadija, whom he married at age, he was 25 when she was 40. Khadija, who was his foremost supporter throughout his life, radiyallahu anha. Khadija, who gave him everything that she could give, radiyallahu anha. Khadija, about whom he said, Allah gave me the rizq to love Khadija. Allah made me love Khadija, radiyallahu anha. Khadija radiyallahu anha, who gave so much to him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that Jibreel alayhi salam comes one day for no other reason, not to bring revelation, not to bring wahi, but rather comes to the house of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and there gives salam to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and then says to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, give salam to Khadija from Allah ta'ala. Give salam to Khadija from Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. And let her know that Allah has promised her, among the many things, a palace in Jannah that is made of a carved pearl in which she will not find fatigue nor difficulties ever. He comes to Khadija and he says, shaking, Zammiluni, Zammiluni, cover me, cover me. Shivering and shaking, and why should he? Shouldn't he? He was embraced by Jibreel alayhi salam. Nabi sallallahu alayhi salam said, I saw Jibreel twice on his real form. His head was in the heavens and his feet in the earth, and he covered the horizon. He had 600 wings. If he was to open one of his wings, he would cover the east and the west. And that was the moment of truth when he was received Nubuwa, and therein he made the statement, لا راحة بعد اليوم. There is no rest after today. And for the next 23 years, there was no rest. Until the moment he was passing away, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when his dear daughter Fatima radiyallahu anha, who was standing next to his head, sad about the fact that he was leaving sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said to her, do not be sad on your father, for there is no sorrow on your father after today. He started the nubuwa by saying there is no rest after today. And he exited this life saying there is no sorrow, there is no sadness on your father after today. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. My brothers and sisters, we don't study the life of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam simply to tell stories and tales. But rather, the most important thing about his life, or the reason we study about his life or talk about him, is to learn how to live his life, is to learn how to come close to him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is to learn to see how he dressed, how he ate, how he walked, how he dealt with people near and far. And that is why tonight, inshallah ta'ala, is one of those nights to try to increase our iman, inshallah, and also to allow us to have some picture about his life, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. To love him, we need to know him. And there is nobody else who could tell us of his description other than the Sahaba radiallahu anhum. There is no one in the history of humanity come in the history of humanity whose life and the details of his life were articulated and were recorded in such details and to such extent than Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And some historians of the seerah and others say that more than half a million people were recorded, the biographies of more than half a million people were recorded who told us about him sallallahu alaihi wasallam, to ascertain the authenticity of his sunnah and his hadith sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We knew that when he walked into his house, he miswaked his teeth sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We knew how he had a smile on his face all the time. We know how he dealt with his wives radiyallahu anhunna. And so his life is no secret. And his private life was public. For he is the guide to all humanity, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. How he smiled at his wife, how when he sat with Aisha to eat, when she drank from the glass, he would take the same glass and turn it to see where her lips matched and drink from the same spot, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We know that when he sat with Aisha and they ate, radiyallahu anha, when she ate a piece of meat and left the bone, when he sucked that bone or the marrow inside the bone, she would take it and do the same with the radiyallahu anha. We know these details. We know when he woke up, what he did, the first thing, he would wash his hands and make the dua. So what did he look like, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? And there are a number of narrations about what he looked like. And inshallah ta'ala, for the benefit of both the Arab brothers and sisters and the non-Arabs, allow me to read a detailed description of how he looked like, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this is by Al-Hasan bin Ali radiyallahu anhu, who said, I asked my auntie Hind, my uncle Hind ibn Abi Hala, wa kana wassafan an hilyati Rasulillahi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَأَنَا أَشْتَهِي أَنْ يَصِفَ لِي مِنْهَا شَيْئًا أَتَعَلَّقُ بِهِ. He said, I asked my uncle to give me a description of Rasulullah sallam such that I can learn and hold fast to. فقال كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فخما مفخما يتلألأ وجهه تلألؤ القمر ليلة البدر أطول من المربوع وأقصر من المشذب عظيم الهامة رجل الشعر إن انفرقت عقيقته فرق وإلا فلا يجاوز شعره شحمة أذنيه إذا هو وفره أزهر اللون واسع الجبينين أزج الحواجب سوابغ في غير قرن بينهما عرق خمصان الأخمصين مسيح القدمين يبنو عنهما الماء إذا زال قلعا يخطو تكفؤا ويمشي هونا ذريع المشية إذا مشى كأنما ينحط من صبب وإذا التفت جميعا خافض الطرف نظره إلى الأرض أطول من نظره إلى السماء جل نظره الملاحظة يسوق أصحابه ويبدأ من لقيه بسلام قلت صف لي منطقه قال كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم متواصل الأحزان دائم الفكرة ليست له راحة لا يتكلم في غير حاجة طويل السكوت يفتتح الكلام ويختمه بأشداقه يتكلم بجوامع الكلم كلامه فصل لا فضول ولا تقصير دمث يدره الغضب أقنى العرنين له نور يعلوه يحسبه من لم يتأمله أشم كث اللحية أدعج سهل الخدين ضليع الفم أشنب مفلج الأسنان دقيق المسربة كأن عنقه جيد دمية في صفياء الفضة معتدل الخلق باد متماسك سواء البطن والصدر عريض الصدر صلى الله عليه وسلم. This is a description and I shall just summarize it. And perhaps one of the best people to summarize it was none other than a lady by the name of Ma'bad رضي الله عنها who had the fortune and the privilege, if you like, to meet him and Abu Bakr رضي الله عنه during the Hijrah. So when he made the Hijrah صلى الله عليه وسلم, on the way he passed by a tent and the lady Ma'bad was there without her husband. And it was a year of drought. And so when he passed, he asked for water, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. She didn't know who he was. And she said, look, you see the situation around us. We don't have anything. Not even the goats are able to give milk. So he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, said, do you allow me to milk these goats? She said, good luck, go and try. And so when he laid his Mubarak hands on the goats, it began to give milk. And this is one of the mu'jizat or the miracles of Rasulullah Sallam that he was given. Another of his mu'jizat was, and nobody else, no other Nabi was given this, by the way, where quite, or in few cases, water would gush forth from between his fingers. This happened a few times, one of which during the Hudaybiyah, when he was there and the truce of Hudaybiyah was taking place and there wasn't enough water left except he came sallallahu alaihi wasallam with some water and he began to make wudu and all of them came to him. He said, what's the matter? They said, we have neither water for wudu or for drinking. So he immersed his hands in the water and water began to gush forth between his fingers. They all drank from it and they filled their containers. And the narrator was asked, how many were you? He says, wallahi, if we were 100,000, it would have been enough for them, but we were 1,000. We were 1,000. And so in this case, Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, the moment he places his blessed hands on the goat, it began to give milk. And he filled the containers and then he went and gave her to drink. Then he sought permission to drink himself and Abu Bakr, and then they went ahead. They went on. Then when her husband came back, he said, I feel there is somebody special was here. And he didn't tell her, I am the messenger of Allah, I demand water, you know. He didn't say that. Then she began to describe him. And see, she said, I saw a man pure and clean with a handsome face and a fine figure. He was not marred by a skinny body, nor was he overly small in the head and neck. He was graceful and elegant with intensely black eyes and thick eyelashes. He was neither short nor tall, but anyone who stood with him felt that the Prophet was taller than him, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Because some ulama said, because Allah Ta'ala wanted him to be greater and higher and better spiritually and physically than anyone else. He was perfect in his appearance, in his khalq and khuluq, and his character, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. They say he was neither tall nor short, but he was moderate size, and he was not fat, and he was not skinny, but he was of good build, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and never in his life had he had a tummy. He was always flat, right? He had a flat tummy, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. They say he wasn't extremely white, nor was he dark. And some of the scholars said Allah Ta'ala deliberately did not make him dark, not because Allah Ta'ala has anything against anyone's color. Of course, Allah Ta'ala is not prejudiced, nor Allah Ta'ala has any favoritism. But Allah knows the unfortunate nature in humans that they have racist tendencies towards black people. And he did not want anyone to have any of these tendencies towards his Habib sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And of course, history proved it, the unfortunate reality of how the so-called Western world and the democratic world dealt with the blacks and the indigenous of all nations. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam, there was a huskiness in his voice. He and his neck was long, and they said it was like a silver bottle, clear and smooth. His beard was thick, and his eyebrows were finely arched, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. When silent, he was grave and dignified. And when he spoke, glory rose up and overcame him. He was from afar the most beautiful and the most glorious. And close up, he was the sweetest and the loveliest. He was sweet of speech and articulate. But he wasn't petty. He wasn't silly. His speech was a string of cascading pearls, measured so that none despaired of its length. When he spoke, all wanted to listen. And he repeated himself thrice so that people understand him. For he was concerned of the affairs of people. By nature, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he was gentle and kind-hearted, always inclined to be gracious and to overlook the faults of others. Politeness and courtesy, compassion and tenderness, simplicity and humility, sympathy and sincerity were some of the keynotes of his character, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. In the cause of right and justice, he could be resolute and severe, but more often than not, his severity was tempered with generosity, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He had charming manners, which won him the affection of his followers and secured their devotion. Although he was a virtual king of Arabia, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and a messenger of Allah Ta'ala, he never assumed an air of superiority. He never came across as superior. He never showed that he is better than others, but always said, I am the son of Adam. I am the son of Adam. I am the son of Adam, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Not that he had to conceal any such vein by practice, for fear of Allah, sincere humility was deeply ingrained in his heart, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. If the prohibitions of Allah were transgressed, he was among the strongest in anger. When it comes for the commands of Allah, he could not tolerate to see them broken. But in correcting those who broke the commands of Allah, he was most gentle, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. A man comes to him and he says, I want to become Muslim, but I love zina. I love to commit adultery. So he said, sit down. And he asked him gently and logically, do you have a mother and a daughter, or you have a sister and you have... He said, yes, I have. He said, would you like anyone to commit zina with your mother? He says, no. Would you like anyone to commit zina with your sister? He said, no. Would you like anyone to commit zina with your auntie? He said, no. He says, then the woman with whom you want to commit zina is the mother of somebody, or the daughter of somebody, or the sister of somebody, or the auntie of somebody. The man said, as soon as he said that to me, I left his presence, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and zina was the most disliked thing in my estimation. When a man, when he was sitting, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as we all know, with the Sahaba, he's sitting with his Sahaba, and that Bedouin walked in. What did the Bedouin do? He went right to the corner and began to urinate in the masjid. Now, the other injunction is Amr bil Ma'ruf wa Nahy al Munkar. You order the good and prevent the evil. And what more evil can be in than one coming to urinate in the masjid of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? And the Sahaba stood up and they wanted to now stop. He said, leave him. Allahu Akbar. Leave him, he said. Let him finish. Not only, let him finish. And the man finished. He finished his business in the masjid. And then Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam called him and nicely and gently told him and taught him. And then he told the Sahaba radiallahu anhum how to clean that najasa, that impurity. And the Sahaba used to say, wallahi, we never saw a teacher better than Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam before him or after him. Alayhi salatu wa sallam. He never was given a choice between two matters, but chose the simplest of the two. When he sat with people and they talked about dunya, he talked about dunya. You know, nowadays you sit with buzruks, you know, some brothers with the big beard and the topi or the umama and the jubba, the miswak hanging outside of the pocket half a meter long. And you sit and if you talk about dunya, they would kill you almost with their eyes. It's like he's talking about the D word, dunya. Yet Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Sahaba say, when we sat with him, if we spoke about the price of food in the market, he spoke about the price of food in the market. If we spoke about swords, he would speak about swords. And if we spoke about akhirah, he would talk about akhirah and tell us a lot of information about akhirah. They said he made us feel belonging. He never made anyone feel better than the other. Each one of us felt closer to him than the other. And unless you went and asked him directly, he will never tell you who he prefers over another. And one Sahabi made that mistake. In fact, he went to Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he said, oh Nabi of Allah, he says, I always felt I am closer to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam than anybody else. Because that's how he made them feel, alayhi salatu wasalam. He said, I felt so close to him that I couldn't resist one day to go and say to him, oh Nabi of Allah, do you love me more or Abu Bakr? Yeah, now you made a mistake, right? And because he is truthful, he says, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. Okay, do you love me more or Umar? He said, Umar radiallahu anhu. But nevertheless, he made everyone feel that he was close to them, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He was continually smiling. He had the worries and the concerns of the world on his shoulders, but he managed to smile, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Now, that a sign of taqwa is to frown. And to show the status of your piety to your wife, you must frown even more. Because she has to know that I'm a wali. You know, I'm in the masjid all the time. We have to read Quran and do dhikr. Smiling is haram. I once saw two brothers arguing somewhere here outside this masjid. And one of them says to the other, you are always smiling. He said, at least there is evidence in the sunnah that Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam always smiled and not frowned like you. He smiled, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When he walked to his house, he had a smile. When he was with his family, he had a smile, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But yet at the same time, there was that deep concern for the affairs of the people around him. So much so that Allah Ta'ala had to remind him in the Quran and to ease his tension. لَعَلَّكَ بَاخِعٌ نَفْسَكَ. Why are you killing yourself over the fact that they are not getting hidayah, O Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? He was so concerned for the well-being of humanity, that he would make dua continuously for their hidayah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He never had an iota of racism in his heart. He never looked at Bilal radiallahu anhu and said, because Bilal was black, Abyssinian, and a slave, therefore I'm not going to give him da'wah, leave him till last. Because hidayah is for everybody. And da'wah is for everybody. And Bilal, when Bilal took shahada before many of the so-called chiefs of Quraysh, Bilal became Bilal radiallahu anhu. Bilal, who when he was persecuted, he was saying ahadun ahad, words that were ringing in the heavens and the earth. Bilal, who was given the privilege of becoming the muadhin of Rasulullah sallam, Bilal, whose name until today, until the day of Qiyamah, will, whenever is uttered, we will say radiyallahu anhu arba. Bilal radiyallahu anhu, who when he was passing away, he asked his wife to bring some musk, mix it in water, and sprinkle it around him. He said, for I shall receive visitors soon who neither eat nor drink, but they love the beautiful fragrance. He was talking about the angel of death and the angels. And as he was departing, his wife was wailing, saying, wa asafa, wa hasrata, what a sorrow, what a loss. He said, oh my wife, do not say what a loss, what a loss, but say wa farhata, wa farhata, ghadan alqa al-ahibba Muhammadan wa sahbah. He says, say, oh what a joy, what a joy, Bilal is leaving this world because he shall meet Muhammad and his friends tomorrow, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This was the sentiment of Bilal radiyallahu anhu. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam forbade three things upon himself. He forbade argument upon himself, he forbade arrogance upon himself, and that which did not concern him. That wasn't part of him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he relieved people of three things. He would not degrade anyone among them or abuse them. Never ever. He never raised his voice in the markets. ما كان صخابا. He wasn't a person who raised his voice in the markets. He wasn't a person who ever used vulgar language. Rather, he is the one who told us, Allah Ta'ala, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُبْغِضُ الْفَاحِشَ الْبَذِيِّ. Allah Ta'ala dislikes an obnoxious person who uses foul language. He never degraded anyone. He never even criticized the food that was presented to him. If he liked it, he ate it. And if he did not like it, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he simply did not eat it. He never said, it doesn't taste nice. He never said, there isn't enough of this in it, or there isn't enough. You know why? Because the concern of the people of Allah Ta'ala is far above the food. Food is not even secondary. If it is there, we eat. They eat. If it is not there, they say, as he used to say when he used to enter and would ask Aisha, is there food? And when she said no, what would he say? Inni sa'im. I am fasting. There is no problems. No divorce ever happened because the food wasn't right. Right? And no arguments between husband and wife happened because she didn't have enough salt or chili or curry or enough tahina in the hummus. Right? These are the trivial aspects of this world, that if food is there, they would eat from. If there was no food, there is no harm. For they were thinking about something that is higher. They didn't spend hours preparing meals because they had time. They needed that time to stand before Allah Azza wa Jal, and that is what he did. He stood so long at night before Allah Azza wa Jal that his feet would swell. And Aisha would say to him, Ya Rasulullah, why are you doing this to yourself? Your feet would swell and crack open. The heels would crack open from long standing in salah. And he would say, and she said, didn't Allah Ta'ala forgive your sins past and future? He says, yes, أَفَلَا أَكُونْ عَبْدًا شَكُورًا. Shall I not be a grateful servant to my Allah Ta'ala? Allahu Akbar. Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam wants to show gratitude to Allah Ta'ala. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who was, no one made dhikr of Allah like he did. Even when his eyes were closed, he says, my eyes close, but my heart does not close. My eyes close, but my heart continues to remember Allah Ta'ala. And he said, I make istighfar in a day 70 times or 100 times. And some of the ulama say he did not make istighfar because of any sin he committed, but of the fact that perhaps and perchance a second in his day passed without dhikr of Allah Azza wa Jal. And he, with this maqam and this status, he says, أَفَلَا أَكُونُ عَبْدًا شَكُورًا. Shall I not be a grateful slave to my Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? My brothers and sisters, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, of course, struggled. His life was a very difficult life, apparently. From outside, it was a very difficult life. From outside, he had to go through the difficulties and the struggle. He would walk in the street and they would throw rubbish at him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. His house, the court of his house, had no ceiling, as the many of the houses then. And so the neighbor, who was a mushrik, would take the rubbish and throw it in the courtyard of Rasulullah sallam. Once, twice, three times, four times, and every day he will take it and clean it, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And then he goes to his neighbor and says, is this what a neighbor does to another? That's all. He is making sujood in front of the Kaaba, and one of the mushriks come and strangles him and puts the intestines of a camel on his neck, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. His beloved daughter Fatima comes running and weeping, and she is cleaning his neck from the intestines, and she weeps and says, is this what you do to a messenger of Allah? He raises his head, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, not a word. He is walking one day with his companions, and he was wearing a Yemeni garment that was woolen, and so it had harsh cloth. He said, as he was walking, the narrator says, as he was walking, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, a man comes and grab him from behind and snatches him so hard that it marked on the blessed neck of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I mean, you imagine you are walking and somebody comes and whacks you so hard in your back. How would you react? And now Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he turns around with a smile. You know why? Because he was a man in control of himself. He was a man in control of his emotions. He was a man, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, who had control over those buttons that if you push any of them, you will explode. You know that button, tung, anger, that's us, right? You go, you know, press that button, he will now scream. You press that button, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam was a perfect human, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He was a model, a role model for all of mankind till the day of Qiyamah. And so he is snatched and he turns around with a smile. And the man says, in addition to add salt to injury, he says, give me from what Allah has given you. Give me money. He says, come with me. And he gives him. Are you satisfied? No. And he gives him more. Are you satisfied? No. And he gives him more. And then until the man is satisfied, he says, I only have one request. What is your request? You know, I think because of what you've done, a feeling of anger may have come in the hearts of my companions towards you, and I don't like that. So maybe you should just make up so that they don't have that feeling in their hearts. He used to say to the Sahaba, when I come to see you, don't tell me anything bad about anyone, for I like to meet all my companions with a clean heart. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In the house, the acid test of akhlaq is in the house with one's wife. For outside, you can be good to your colleagues, and in the masjid we meet each other 5-10 minutes, you can have a nice superficial smile on your face, you know, and pretend to be mashallah this and that. But when you go to the house, one can be like Fir'aun, or worse or less. Depends, there are levels of fara'ina, you know, Fir'aun is different levels. And so the acid test is inside the house. That's why Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, the best among you, or the best believers, are those who are best in akhlaq, and those who are best in akhlaq or character are those who are best to their family, their wives. And I am the best to my wives, he said. So Aisha was asked when he passed away, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, how was he in the house? Now this is the acid test. How was he, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, in the house? She said, Wallahi kana ka. He was like any other man. He used to help us clean. He used to help. He looked after himself, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He never demanded anything. You know, he didn't imagine the typical Muslim figure today goes home after work, sits on the couch, puts leg on leg, and then says, "Coffee. Where's the food?" Commanding. One sheikh said, if a man knew the status of his wife who is making so much khidmah in the house, he would be the one making her coffee. Because a woman, a mother in the house, the motherhood is the greatest job a woman can have. Unfortunately, modern society has made it otherwise. Motherhood now is frowned upon. You have to be a working mother, you have to have a career. And if there is need for a woman to work in the right place, there is no harm, of course. But motherhood is the greatest status, the greatest maqam. And Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, when he was asked by a woman that the men go for jihad, they go for struggle, they go for fighting, and what about us? We want to do the same. Because we want to compete with men when it comes to good deeds. And there's two versions. One version he says, jihad of a woman is hajj. And another is that if a woman stays in her house, she prays her 5 times salah, she looks after her deen, she looks after her family, she is in jihad. So the sheikh said, if a man knew that his wife is actually in jihad inside the house, when he comes home, he should do the coffee. He should do the khidmah. And so Nabi Salam was like this in his house, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. With children, he was wonderful. Anas radiallahu anhu said, I served Rasulullah sallam 10 years. He never said to me for anything that I have done, why have you done that? And he never said to me for anything that I didn't do, why didn't you do that? He says, and I have never, Anas says, radiallahu anhu, I have never felt hands softer than the hands of Rasulullah sallam. I have never felt silk or velvet softer than the hands of Rasulullah sallam. And I never smelt a fragrance that emanated from him, from anyone, than the fragrance of Rasulullah sallam. He was tayyib when he was alive, and he was tayyib when he passed away, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He was beautiful in fragrance when he was alive, and his fragrance intensified when he died, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Ali radiallahu anhu says, "Tibta hayyan wa mayyitan ya Rasulullah." When he was standing there next to him, and Nabi sallam was passing away, he says, "You were beautiful, and you smelt beautiful when you were alive, and you do continue to do the same when you are dead, Nabi of Allah, sallallahu alaihi wasallam." He went to visit Anas's house one day. And Anas had a younger brother, Umayr. And Nabi Sallam noticed that Umayr was sitting in the corner sad. If Anas was a young boy and Umayr was even younger. So he went to him and he says, "What is the matter?" And he said, "My little bird passed away, Nughayr." And so Nabi Sallam soothed his tension. And he said, that is life. Things come and things go. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. One day he was in a very important mission. And this is a good lesson for the da'is particularly. The brothers involved in da'wah and so on. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was in a very important mission. He was waiting, as you know, for an opportunity to give da'wah to the chiefs of Quraysh. For it was only the underdogs who were listening to him. And now he wanted to give da'wah to the chiefs of Quraysh. And they have now permitted him. They all gathered together in one house. And they said to him, come and talk to us about your message. And now he is there. Can there be anything more important? He is in Gasht, you know, he's in Jawla. He's visiting. And he's sitting there with the chiefs of Quraysh giving them da'wah. He's been waiting for this opportunity for a long time. In the house, his daughter, radiallahu anha, is holding her baby, and the baby is passing away. The grandson of whom? The grandson of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So she sends a message to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, come now because your grandson is dying. He sends the messenger back and he says to him, tell her, antasbir wa tahtasib, inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Tell my daughter to have patience and just to remember that Allah will reward her And inna lillahi, for Allah what he gave and for him what he takes. She sent the messenger back. Tell him, wallahi la ya'tiyanna al-an. She said, tell him, wallahi, he will have to come now. So he said, okay. So he left and he came to his dear wife, a daughter. And when he was there now, he grabbed his grandson. And as the grandson was passing away, tears started out of the eyes of Rasulullah. Who is watching? The Sahaba. Now, the idea is that if you're a man, you don't cry. Right? And for those Arabs who grew up in the desert, they're Bedouins, these people, they were tough and rough, and crying wasn't part of manhood. And like in modern society, the same, you know, it's sometimes because of arrogance, really. And so Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam cried. And they said, oh my God, you are crying? Why are you crying? What's this? He says, that is rahmah, which Allah places in the hearts of his slaves. It is mercy. He wasn't weeping, he wasn't wailing. He was showing emotions. One day when he was sitting, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he was kissing his grandchildren, Al-Hassan and Hussein and others, a man by the name of Aqra' bin Habis, he said, you kiss the children? He said to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you kiss your children? He said, of course. He said, I have 10 children, I never kissed any of them. Allahu Akbar. You know, see how tough they were? Brother, forget kissing children. They used to bury their daughters alive. And these same people were transformed so much that Abu Bakr, when he stands in Salah, as soon as he starts reading a few verses, he begins to weep. When Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was passing away, he ordered that Abu Bakr should lead the Salah, but Aisha radiallahu anha said, she didn't convey the message to Abu Bakr. He said, did you tell him? Go and tell him. She said, I didn't tell him. Why? She says, because Abu Bakr, raqiq al-qalb, he's a man whose heart is so soft that if he begins to lead the prayer, nobody is able to hear his recitation because of his crying. Umar radiallahu anhu, who also indulged in that practice of killing daughters alive before Islam, when he becomes a Muslim and a Khalifa, two black lines on his face because of excessive weeping out of the fear of Allah Azza wa Jal. Total transformation. Total transformation. Radiallahu anhu. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was also good to everybody, to the old women, to the young, to the enemies, to the foes. And he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was first and foremost close to Allah Ta'ala than any other human being. And of course his difficulties or his life wasn't that smooth. You see, when he went to Ta'if, the people of Mecca did not want to listen to his message. So he walks on foot with Zayd radiallahu anhu to Ta'if, 60 miles on foot. And anyone who's been to Hajj knows how difficult that would have been. As soon as he arrives in Ta'if, not only they refuse him the basic hospitality that the Arabs were known for, but also they refuse to listen to him, and now they pushed him out of Ta'if, not even in a nice way, rather they formed two lines and they asked people to pelt him with stones, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Zayd radiallahu anhu said, I continued to protect him from the stones that were being thrown at him, but I could not do so much. I could only do so much that both of them began to bleed, and Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam bled profusely, that his feet were clogged in his sandals, until he managed to leave them and he came to a particular location where he actually fainted, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Allah Ta'ala is watching and looking at what is happening, so he sends him an angel, the angel of the two mountains surrounding Mecca, Al-Akhshabain. And now this angel, he gives Nabi sallam this choice. He says, Allah Ta'ala has seen what they have done to you, and Allah is giving you a choice. If you so wish, he will collapse the two mountains surrounding Mecca on its people. Now justice would demand that, or retribution would demand that, you know, an eye for an eye. But Nabi صلى الله عليه وسلم taught us something greater, and that is rahmah, shafaqah, compassion and mercy. And the dua that he made at that instant was so powerful and moving that reflects his deep connection with Allah Azza wa Jalla. And he, instead of complaining against them, and instead of showing any signs of ingratitude, or instead of showing any sign that, you know, I'm the messenger of Allah, that's how they deal with me, rather, he turned to Allah and he said, Allahumma ilayka ashku da'fa quwwati. Oh Allah, I complain to you of my own weakness, wa qillata hilati, and my feebleness, وَهَوَانِ عَلَى النَّاسِ, and my being seen as little and insignificant in the eyes of people. يَا أَرْحَمَ الرَّاحِمِينَ, O most merciful of those who show mercy. أَنْتَ رَبُّ الْمُسْتَضْعَفِينَ, you are the Lord of those people who are weak. وَأَنْتَ رَبِّي, and you are my Lord. إِلَى مَنْ تَكِلَنِي, to whom are you going to leave me? إلى بعيد يتهجمني أم إلى عدو ملكته أمري, to a close friend who is attacking me, or to an enemy who is fighting me. He's complaining to Allah Ta'ala about his weakness. صلى الله عليه وسلم, إن لم يكن بك علي غضب فلا أبالي. Here is the crux of the matter. Oh Allah, as long as you are not displeased with me, I don't care. It doesn't matter what they do to me. As long as you are pleased with me, it doesn't matter what they do unto me. وَلَكِنْ عَافِيَتُكَ, all I am asking is your afia, your pleasure and acceptance. هِيَ أَوْسَعُ لِي, it is greater for me than anything else that I can think of. أَعُوذُ بِنُورِ وَجْهِكَ الَّذِي أَشْرَقَتْ لَهُ الظُّلُمَاتِ, I seek refuge in the glory an illumination and light of your face or countenance that lit the darkness. وَصَلَحَ عَلَيْهِ أَمْرُ الدُّنْيَا وَالْآخِرَةِ مِنْ أَن تُنَزِّلَ بِي غَضَبَكَ, oh Allah, I seek refuge in you that your anger may come upon me. أَوْ يَحِلَّ عَلَيَّ سَخُطَكَ, or that you may become displeased with me. لَكَ الْعُتْبَى حَتَّى تَرْضَى, I shall complain to you until you are pleased. وَلَا حَوْلَ وَلَا قُوَّةَ إِلَّا بِاللَّهِ, and there is no might, no power except in Allah. Allahu Akbar. Ya Allah, he says, I complain to you of my own weakness. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. My brothers, when Nabi sallam, and just to wrap up, Nabi sallam opened Mecca. The victory that was Mecca, when he sallam entered victorious, the nobility and the dignity and the greatness that he showed at that moment of time was never ever seen in the history of mankind and will never be seen again. For until that moment, it was the custom of all emperors, kings, and empires that whenever they entered victorious into any city that they have been fighting for years, the first thing they would do is obliterate that city, massacre its men and women, and enslave their children. And unfortunately, the same mentality continues to be applied in today's warfare. Yet when he entered victorious, after 21 years of persecution, despite the fact that they used to drag his companions in the streets of Mecca, despite the fact that they sanctioned him 3 years, due to which his uncle passed away and then Khadija passed away, despite the fact that they abused him, despite the fact that they throw stones at him, despite the fact that they attempted to assassinate him again and again, despite the fact that they prevented him the least hospitality, and despite the fact that they killed 70 of his greatest Sahaba in Uhud, and despite the fact that they broke his tooth, and they cut his forehead, and almost killed him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the first thing he does when he enters Mecca, he says, I say to you what Yusuf said to his brothers, لا تثريب عليكم اليوم, there is no harm on you today. Go, you are all free. and to make it clear to them and to make them feel a sense of security, he says, whoever enters his house is safe. Whoever enters the house of Abu Sufyan is safe. Whoever enters the Kaaba is safe. In other words, only if you are standing in front of us with a sword wanting to fight, otherwise we are not going to cause any harm unto anyone. Hind, that lady who not only killed the Hamza, the uncle of Rasulullah, or ordered his assassination. Hind, who at once wanted men to dig the grave of the mother of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Hind, whose heart was full of anger, was full of hate towards Islam and Muslim. Even she became Muslim after the Fath of Mecca and became a Sahabiyya radiyallahu anha. Ikrima, the same thing. Radiyallahu anhu, because of the greatness of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, despite all of what they have done to him, he stands there and he says, I say to you what my brother Yusuf said to his brothers, go, you are all forgiven and you are all free. And one historian, Western historian once said, he said, the greatness of a leader is displayed at time of victory. And the greatness of his character and nobility is shown and displayed at time of victory. And never has anyone seen a more honorable and noble and great leader like Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, who, despite what they have done to him, entered Mecca and forgave the people. This is the hallmark of greatness, my brothers. And of course, the pages of history had to come to an end and they had to be folded. And so Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam's moment of truth came when his mission has finalized and he delivered the mission. And there is nothing that brings us closer to Jannah but he told us about. And nothing that will take us away from Jahannam but he warned us against. When there was nothing that we needed to know to save ourselves in dunya and akhirah, but was revealed to us when his mission was completed. And when he had fulfilled his task in the best manner, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he had to leave this world. And it started with that poison that was put in the shoulder of a lamb, because he used to love the shoulder from a lamb. And a Jewish woman put some poison in his shoulder, in the shoulder. And when the Sahaba ate from it and he began to eat, then he said, stop, do not eat, for it told me that it has been poisoned. And he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, used to suffer from migraines or headaches. And at times he passes by Aisha and Aisha would say, wa ra'sah, oh my headache. And he would say, bal ana wa ra'sah, but rather it is I who has a headache. My headache is worse than yours, Aisha. Kana yu'ak kama yu'ak ar-rajulan. He used to suffer at the time of death like any two other men. That pain that he went through, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He was offered that if he wanted, he can stay forever as a king in this world, but he chose to be in the company of Ar-Rafiq Al-A'la, the company of the closest friend in the most high position. He wanted his Lord. He says, Inni mushtaqun li Rabbi, I miss my Lord. And the last advice, yet even when he was dying, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what comes out of his mouth? Ummati, ummati, my ummah, my ummah. As-salah wa ma malakat aymanukum. Salah, salah, salah. He calls Fatima and he whispers in her ear once, so she weeps, she begins to cry. And then he whispers in her ear again and she smiles. And it's only after Rasulullah ﷺ passed away that she was asked by some of his wives, what is it that he told you that made you weep initially and then smile? She said, he said to me the first time that he is leaving this dunya, so I wept. And then he said to me, O Fatima, you will be the first from my people, my family to follow me. And 6 months after she died, radiyallahu anha. is to wash his body? Who is to make salah on him? Who is to be imam on the imam? Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the malaika first come to make the salah on him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Saf after saf. And then the sahaba radiyallahu anhum. When they came to put him in the grave and they began to throw dust on him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Fatima came crying. She says, Ahanat alaykum anfusakum. And takubbu alayhi turab. How is it possible for you that you throw the soil on Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? How could you do it? But he is at the end of the day a human being. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the ayat that the sheikh read and in the salah and also in the that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was not the father of any of you, but a messenger and a human being who came as a bashir and a nadir, a giver of glad tidings and a forerunner of a punishment that is to come. My brothers and sisters, we ask Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala to give us the tawfiq and the understanding to love him more than ourselves, our fathers, our sisters, our mothers, our children, our wealth, and to follow his example. And if I may recommend one thing, and that is to actually go and study the seerah. They say, "Man arafa seerah asbahat alayhi da'wa yaseera." If you know the seerah, then da'wa or fulfilling your purpose and mission becomes easy for you. But if you don't know the seerah, fulfilling that mission will not be easy. There are many books that one can read. I'm happy, and the imams here are happy to point you out to some of these books and for you to study them. May Allah Ta'ala give us the tawfiq, inshallah Ta'ala. Jazakumullah khair. Aqul subhanakallahu bihamdik. Nashhadu an la ilaha illa anta. Nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk.